Hey, it's Baker Bettie, and today I thought we would chat about how to transform a yeasted bread recipe into a sourdough recipe, which is one of the most common questions I get. Often when I will post a yeasted bread recipe, people will ask me how they can convert it into a sourdough recipe. So let's talk about that today. I have a bit of a process I go through when I try to do this. Now, I will make a disclaimer that it's really important to have a pretty good understanding of how sourdough works and how the general bread process works if you want to make this conversion. So if you are not familiar with those two things, I'm going to link some videos down in the description box that can help you get a little more familiar with those things before you try to do this for yourself. I'll also say that the availability of sourdough recipes on the internet right now is vast. So pretty much any type of bread you would like to make as a sourdough version, you're going to be able to find a recipe for on the internet. So if you're somebody that doesn't want to go through the whole process of making all of the conversions for yourself, you should be able to find a recipe. So to start, we need to decide how much of our sourdough starter we want to put into our bread dough. And you might think that this is a really simple conversion of however much yeast there is in your original recipe, this is how much sourdough starter you should use. But it really isn't that simple. Now, some people say that 100 grams of sourdough starter has about the same rising power as one package or 7 grams of yeast. And so you can use that as your starting point. However, I like to assess a few other things before I decide how much I want to put into my new recipe. So to demonstrate this, let's look at my traditional cinnamon roll recipe. Now for something like a cinnamon roll, we are working with an enriched dough, which is something that has things like butter, eggs, sugar, milk, enriching ingredients in it. Now these bread doughs tend to rise more slowly than a lean dough, which is a dough that doesn't have those enriching ingredients in it. So for an enriched dough, we might want to use a higher ratio of sourdough starter as compared to a lean dough. Now, the other thing to consider is the flavor that you are going for with your recipe. For an enriched dough, for something like a cinnamon roll, I don't want a super, super strong sourdough flavor, maybe just a little bit of a sourdough flavor. So in that instance, I would even want to use a higher ratio of sourdough starter because when things ferment more quickly, they're going to have less of that sourdough flavor. So a higher ratio of starter is actually going to give you less sour flavor. Now, the percentage that you might want to put in your dough can vary widely. I typically try to keep it around 10% to 30%. And those percentages are baker's percentages. So if you are not familiar with how baker's percentages work, I also have a very detailed video explaining the process of how to figure out baker's percentages and what they mean. But I typically try to keep it in that 10 to 30% range based on what kind of dough I am making and what the flavor is I'm looking for. So for something like a cinnamon roll dough, where it's an enriched dough and I'm not looking for a really strong sourdough flavor, I might want to get really close to that 30% mark. So when you add sourdough starter into a recipe, you want to keep the hydration level the same. And in order to do that, we need to adjust the amount of flour and liquid in the original recipe to compensate for the flour and water that is in our sourdough starter. So most sourdough starters are 100% hydration starters, which means they are equal amounts flour and water by weight. So when we are adding 100 grams of starter into our recipe, we are technically adding 50 grams of flour and 50 grams of water, which means we need to reduce the original flour amount by 50 grams and the original liquid amount by 50 grams, which will keep the hydration level the same. So once I have made those adjustments to my recipe, I can look at this new formula and determine what percentage my sourdough starter is at in this formula. So my flour is at 450 grams. I'm going to take 100 grams, divide that by 450 grams, and multiply that by 100, which gives me 22%. So that's a little bit lower than I want to be for this recipe, so I'm going to increase my starter a little bit and then rework the formula and see where we're at. If I increase my starter amount to 120 grams, I need to decrease the original flour amount by 60 grams and the original liquid amount by 60 grams as well, and that gives me my new formula. So now when I work out my baker's percentages again, I am now at 27% starter in this recipe, which is a lot closer to where I would want to be for a cinnamon roll recipe. I could even increase this a little bit more if I wanted to. Now, the other small change you're going to want to make to your recipe is decreasing the liquid temperature in your recipe. So most yeast bread recipes are going to call for liquids somewhere around 110 to 120 degrees Fahrenheit. Now that is too hot for sourdough starter. It typically cannot withstand heats as high as dry yeast can. So you want to reduce that temperature, and there is actually a formula you can use to determine your ideal liquid temperature so that your bread dough is at the ideal temperature. I don't want to get into all of that in this video. I can make a separate video of that, and I can leave the formula down in the description, but typically you want to be somewhere around 80 to 90 degrees Fahrenheit. So if your kitchen is very warm, you might want to go on the cooler end. And if your kitchen is very cold, you might want to go closer to that 90 degree Fahrenheit end. Also, if your original yeasted bread recipe calls for proofing your yeast, you're just going to eliminate that step and just go straight into mixing your dough. So after you figure out your new formula for your new recipe, you want to assess your rising times. Now, unfortunately, there is no one definitive way to figure out what your rising times are going to be because it's going to vary greatly based on a lot of different factors. Based on how warm or cool your room temperature is, how warm or cool your liquid was, the strength of your sourdough starter and how much starter you put in your recipe, all of those things are going to affect how long it takes your bread dough to rise. So I always suggest the first time you make your new recipe, try to do it on a day where you're going to be home all day and you have a lot of flexibility with your schedule. And then you can get a better idea of what the rising time is going to be for the next time you make your dough. That said, your rising times are always going to be much longer than with a yeasted dough recipe, unless you're starting from a yeasted dough recipe that already has a very, very long fermenting time. If you're starting from a yeasted dough recipe that has 1, 2, 3 hour rising times, your sourdough recipe is always going to take much longer than that. Because commercial yeast is specifically cultivated for a really specific strain of yeast that works very quickly and efficiently to leaven bread. And I know it might sound like 2 to 3 hours might not sound very quick, but in yeast world, it is very quick. So just keep in mind that your rising times are probably going to be at least double, if not much longer than that. So this is where learning how to read your dough is really important. Learning how to visually assess when it looks like your bulk fermentation process is over and when it looks like your proofing process is over. So when I made this sourdough cinnamon roll recipe, which I will leave the link for the full recipe down in the description box as well. There will be lots of links in the description box. But when I first made this batch of sourdough cinnamon rolls, my first rise, the bulk fermentation phase, took about 10 hours. And in my original recipe, it takes about 1 to 1.5 hours for instant yeast, which means my bulk fermentation phase took 10 times longer. Now I'm okay with that because I know it's going to be a very flavorful recipe. And I know that in the future I can mix this dough at night and it will be ready for me to shape in the morning. Now the extended rising times are always going to be heavily front loaded. So that bulk fermentation phase is always going to be much more extended than the proofing phase, because once you get to the part where you're shaping and proofing your bread, your sourdough starter is much more active and it's going to rise that much quicker than in that very first phase. So keep that in mind. Usually the bulk fermentation is much longer and then the proofing phase will be longer, but not quite as much as that first phase. So if you look here at my sourdough cinnamon roll dough, you can tell that it is ready to be shaped because it is rounding in the bowl and I can just tell that it's filled with air. And typically you want to look for it to increase in size by at least 50%. Now, sourdough dough doesn't always rise quite as much as a yeasted dough does because, like I said before, that commercial yeast is just so powerful and efficient. So you want to see it rounding in the bowl, you want to see that it is filled with air and increased in size by about 50%. So now after I shaped my cinnamon rolls, these proofed and were ready to bake in about 90 minutes. So the original recipe had you proof for about 45 minutes for instant yeast. which means it was about double the length of time for the proofing phase, which is definitely longer than the original, but it's not 10 times as long like the bulk fermentation phase. So again, it's going to be heavily front loaded. Now, the way I know that these are ready to go into the oven is when you kind of press down into your roll, you can tell that the indentation is filling in slowly. It takes about 1 to 2 seconds to fill in, and it's not just immediately popping back up. If it just quickly pops back up, that means it needs a little bit more time to proof before you bake it. Now, if you press in on your dough and that indentation does not come up at all, or it almost feels like your dough is about to collapse, you actually have overproofed your dough, and I would still recommend baking it. It's still going to taste great, but there's not really coming back from overproofing. It's probably going to be a pretty dense bread. You definitely want to watch your dough, check in on it, see how it's progressing so that you don't go too far with it. You can use this technique really for any yeasted dough recipe. If you have a favorite yeasted dough recipe that you would like to try out as a sourdough, write out the formula, do the math, try and work it out for yourself, and give it a shot. It might take you a few tries to get to the point where you're really happy with it, but that's kind of the joy of sourdough. It's not an exact science. It's really a living and breathing process, and you really have to learn how to assess things and adjust as you go, and that's one of the things that I love so much about it. So I really hope you found today's video helpful, and if you did, please give it a thumbs up and make sure you subscribed with the notifications turned on so you never miss a video. And you can always ask me questions down in the comment section. I do my best to answer them, and I'll see you back next time with another baking tutorial. Bye.